Here we go.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the November 12th, 2015 meeting of the Municipal Budget Committee. If everyone would rise and pledge allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And if we could start around the table with introductions, and we'll go and start on Nick's side tonight.
Nick Brado.
Scott Blair.
Mike Pierce.
Jones.
Sonny Kravitz.
Jim O'Loughlin.
Brian Lapham.
Eileen Latimer, Chair.
Stephen LeBranch.
Bob Ladd.
Mike Plouffe.
Jerry Zanoy here.
Hi, Phil Bean.
Thank you, everyone. Well, we've efficiently gotten through these sessions without a long lecture, and I have no desire to have tonight be the exception. Some copies of the agenda, and we can pass them around the table. However, the order's going to change a little bit. Yeah, it's all here, but... I don't see anybody with us tonight with trustees of trust funds, or do we hiding? No?
Nope.
Okay.
Revenues.
Then what we will do is we will start out with assessing, and then we'll do the Conservation Commission.
Yep.
If the trustees come in, we'll put them in third order.
There's nothing.
And then, because we are a captive audience, Christie will go through revenues and long-term debt. It's okay with you? All right, so we're all on the same page. I think this starts on page 5, and the OBS is... Anybody can chime up that's on it. 3. Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Tinker. How are you?
Good, and yourself?
I'm good, thank you. Happy to see you.
Yes, nice to be here.
And I assume you'll bring us some good news tonight.
Other than the budget, we can talk about good news if you'd like, we can.
I'm sorry?
We can talk about good news if you want.
I think it would be lovely, while everybody settles down here and gets their pages, you could give us a little bit of good news.
Okay, hopefully it's good news. I did send out an update back in October. I sent to you as well.
Mm-hmm.
Just update you on the condition or the preparation we're making for the 2016 revaluation. We're in the process now of reviewing sales. Just to let you know that this year we currently have, for the equalization ratio study that we do on a yearly basis, we're looking at about 450 sales, which typically in the past few years we've looked at between 250 and 350 sales. So the market's been really good. The appreciation on those sales has been really good. The market seems to be continuing at that pace in Hampton.
Could you throw a percentage at that, what you're seeing?
You know, there's pockets, the overall percentage would be about 12% based on the assessment to sale ratio. However, if you look at properties or neighborhoods on an individual basis, we were out in the field today looking at those. We are seeing some neighborhoods in the 20 to 30% appreciation range. So we're not really sure, you know, where the results will be next April 1, but it appears that the market overall is much greater than the 12% as a total variation from current assessments. With all the new development, we're actually looking at more than likely having over 1,000 sales to analyze as part of the revaluation, which is really good that most neighborhoods in town will have multiple sales, which will give us a better guide, a better ability to value those, you know, at or near market. So we'll have a lot of supporting data for that. New development has been, as you know, the past few years, has been very substantial. That's the same thing that's going to happen again this year. We've currently entered 90-something new condominium units for this year coming up for 2016. In 15, we added over 120-something new condominium units. So the condo market has been pretty good. Just to let you know, we're approaching 3,000 residential condo units in town as a total. That compared to other towns, we're talking, you know, we're over 50% in just the condominiums in relation to some of the communities on the seacoast. We're also approaching over 9,000 parcels. Actually, we've topped 9,000 parcels and expect to, if things continue even at a minimal of the rate it's been continuing, I can see us hitting 10,000 parcels within another couple of years. The majority of those are taxable. There's only a few hundred that are exempt, town, state, and non-taxable churches, that type of entities. So we're looking at, you know, the town growing at a pretty good rate in the past few years. So we're hoping that the reval goes good. We're hoping that the appreciation we see is substantial, you know, being fair and equitable in doing that. But that's what we're hoping for, and we're hoping that development continues. We did add, you know, 10 new homes on Hilliard Ave down on Winneconnet Road, but there's been this year, I think, close to 20 or 25 demolition permits that have been issued. So we're seeing a lot of tear down and new development, and the development of the new properties are bigger and better single-family homes. So there's been a lot of value increases that way as well. So things are looking pretty good at the moment. So.
Thank you. Before we get into the budget, does anyone have any questions for the assessor?
Okay. I have just a couple of quick ones.
On the budget?
On the budget.
Okay.
Did you want me to go over it first?
Let's have him go over the budget first.
No, okay, you can go, yeah.
Just, yeah.
You can wait.
I did want to go over that because there's two items I did want to discuss. But overall, the budget, it appears, is going up 14.6% of proposed. The majority of that value, $40,000 of that, is relative to the contracted services line item. That line item has to do with the defense of values in appeal cases. It requires, in appeal cases, the majority of those cases are very complex and require expert appraisal reports and expert testimony at trial. That's an item that, if you look back, in 2013, that line item was it was funded for our department beginning in 2013. Prior to that, that line item, or the funds that paid for those expert reports and that expert testimony, was through the attorney's
through the budget, legal budget.
So in 2013, the first year that we funded it with $60,000. That year we only used 41% of that. Mm-hmm. In 2014, we only used 70% of that $60,000. The reason for the request of the increase is that this year, and it has to do with how appeals are filed and how they are heard, they don't file them and immediately get heard. They can drag on for multiple years. They can end up requiring multiple reports even before we go to trial. But when we do go to trial, we need those reports, so we do have to prepare them ahead of time. The issue this year was that we had four or five complex utility appraisals that all came to hearing or to date. Dates were set at Superior Court and at the BTLA, where we had to prepare our expert as well as get those reports completed. So if you look at it over a three-year span, I believe we're basically at the $60,000 per year number. The problem with appeals is that you can't look at just one year, because again, every year companies, private individuals, whoever, can file an appeal. It doesn't automatically get scheduled at the courts or at the BTLA. BTLA sometimes is a year and a half, 2 years behind. Courts the same way.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the reason for the overage this year, and that's the reason for the request of the increase to $100,000 from $60,000.
Just a question on that. You're saying we dealt with 405 this year in 2015?
This year alone, the ones that actually were scheduled in 11,
right.
they were filed in 11, either between postponements, delays, court scheduling, BTLAs. We finally ended up hearing several
out now
this year.
Now, how many do you anticipate, or how many have been scheduled for 2016?
We currently have one scheduled, and this is a good point, because the one scheduled for March of 16 was actually supposed to be heard today and tomorrow at Superior Court. But Superior Court could not hear it on 2 days. So instead of doing one day now, one day down the road, we had to reschedule. So that actually will go now till March.
So we have only one on the agenda. But that one was not part of that 405 this year.
With preparing the reports, it was.
It was.
And so preparing the experts, because the trial would have been today.
So is that partially prepaid at this point?
That's been paid, so yes, exactly.
Okay. So going forward, we have that one paid, but nothing?
Not the expert report. I mean, the expert report's paid, but not the expert testimony. Okay. So we'll still need that.
Yes.
Now, the problem which took place in 11 was that, and this is not just Hampton, but multiple communities all across the state, all the utility companies have been appealing their values.
Mm-hmm.
Unitil had 20 appeals throughout the state. PSNH had over 50. They did not appeal here. So Aquarian Water has multiple appeals. We don't know who's going to appeal. And this round, since 2011, it's been utilities. Utilities have been appealing all over the state.
Mm-hmm.
There's no, I'm sorry. There's just no
nope
way to come to a meeting. Discreetly,
let's grab
I'm
a
sorry
chair.
But Sandy, we're going to welcome you verbally so that our secretary, who's not in the room, knows that you are now with us. Thank you for being here tonight. Okay, and I think I understand that one.
We just, like I said, we just don't know when mm-hmm things are going to get heard or things are going to get scheduled.
Okay. But in your estimation, you think that you'll be seeing more cases come due in this coming year, in 2016?
We'd anticipate that it would continue. It hasn't seemed to stop. And with the reval, the potential for new appeals being filed.
Mm-hmm.
That's why looking at it over a five-year period makes more sense than looking at, for this line item, an individual year. Because again, some years we may spend 50% of it. We don't want to spend 200% of it, but that it was like it just happened that 4 or 5 got scheduled all at the same time.
Now, is there anything else that's contracted other than legal and the appeals process out of that line?
Anything where we need an expert report or expert testimony would come out of that line.
So it's basically legal expert testimony, not
right.
All right.
Okay.
The other line item that I wanted to discuss, although it appears to be going up 129%, basically it's going from $1,700 to $3,900, and that's the motor vehicle allowance rebate refund, for mileage. That would relate to myself, my assistant Charlene, and the contract data collector that we have. But with the increase in sales, the increase in permits, plus the cyclical work, the mileage and the amount of time out on the road has increased greatly. Now that the reval is underway, that's only going to get greater. So that's the line item we're requesting that increase for.
Okay, now the contract person, what line do we have, or are we expending for him? Is that under regular wages?
Part-time wages. Yeah.
Okay.
And this will be the last year for that that line item.
Okay. Okay. Questions?
Just a clarification, that contract services, 2011, it was $79,000, so.
Yeah, it wouldn't be through my budget, though. It's one of the, I'm going to talk.
But I'm saying, in your actuals for '14, that account had an expense of $79,553, so I don't know whether it was different contracted services than what we're using for now.
Oh, in 2011, I'm sorry, 2011, we did a revaluation. I believe that was a revaluation line.
Okay.
Would that have been the line that we used for the revi, yeah, we, in 2011?
Oh, yeah, that was part of the evaluation.
That was a revaluation that we did.
Okay.
Yeah. And that's what you'll see in next year's budget. There'll be a line item for the revaluation.
Yeah. Okay.
Michael?
I am a little confused on this one, Ed, about the contracted services.
Mm-hmm.
We've been floating along in that account for, I think it was budgeted for $60,000 for a long time, and it's always been floating under that. And we're up to, I think the last count, about $120,000 just for this year. And you want to increase it to $100,000. Who are some of the people that we've had to do all this special money spending on, like?
Yeah, what are the utilities?
Which utilities are we specifying here?
Well, we did, line items was for Foss Manufacturing. Foss Manufacturing had appealed their property value.
Uh-huh.
I believe that was back in 11 or 12.
Yeah.
Let me get.
That's not a utility.
No, well, it wasn't just utilities, but I'm just saying that utilities are more complex, requiring more work and a more detailed report. They're
yeah.
much more expensive than doing a commercial appraisal, a utility appraisal is.
But you had somebody contracted to do FOSS. Contracted services.
Right.
For FOSS, okay.
Yeah. So we, let me just give you some of the line items here. Okay.
That'd be nice.
So we had Northern Utilities.
What is it?
Northern Utilities and Unitil. They're the same company, but they both the gas and the electric filed an appeal
right.
in 2011. That was it was settled this year. Well, it was a negotiated settlement this year, but it took, of course, this is the fifth year, so we had to get reports done because the settlement was through the settlement negotiations prior to trial,
mm-hmm.
like a month before trial. So all the reports had to be done.
Okay.
We had to have multiple reports for both of those companies for the 2015 trial that was coming up.
Okay.
Again, I talked about Aquarian Water.
Yeah.
That trial was today and tomorrow, has been rescheduled. We had to get the report done for that. That's the third report we had to get done.
March now of 16?
Yeah. March of 16. We had Hampton River Marina, although it's not a utility, that was a multi-year appeal that we needed because of the income stream. We had to have an appraisal done. It wasn't a utility appraisal, but it was an appraisal from Crafts Appraisal, who does a lot of our work for us.
Okay.
We had to get an appraisal done. That was a multi-year appeal, which is still pending for 13 and 14. We're waiting to hear about 13 being withdrawn. However, 14 still pending. More than likely, they'll file for 15. Because income and expenses are a year-to-year thing, we have to do reports for individual years when we're dealing with multiple year appeals. We can't do a value for 1 year and expect to use it
right.
2 or 3 years later.
I follow that.
Yep. We have a pending appeal with Fairpoint that has not been scheduled yet. We haven't done a lot of work on that as of date, but we have done a little bit. We have not done our reports for that yet. Again, I talked about Foss Manufacturing. I didn't talk about it. Foss Manufacturing was another one where we needed to reports done for that one.
Okay.
Because of the complexity of that company. Foss and I think that was dealt with in 2014. We also had an appeal of assisted living and nursing facility on Lafayette Road.
Okay.
That was another expense because of the complexity of the nursing home, the income stream. So those are some of the ones that were recent that we had to get appraisal reports done and also have expert testimony at the same time.
So what kind of money is at risk if we just let it all go and then we honored their request? How many millions of dollars would that be, roughly? I'm just ballpark.
Yeah, I mean.
So I'm just wondering.
Some of these are.
Significant, huh?
Yeah, the thousand, I mean, one here is like 69, almost $100,000 to return.
Okay, so.
Appraisal may cost $25,000. Testimony may cost another few, but it's between that or giving back $100,000.
I just wanted to make sure we were doing it from an economical point of view. We're spending $5 to get a dollar back.
We've always been under this assumption that to just settle and give money back opens the door, if that word gets out.
Oh, yeah.
That everybody's going to file.
Sure.
I mean, I think the best thing to do
Even
is
I
fight,
would.
But it costs money to fight. Yeah, so.
Thank you.
Yep.
That's my question.
Okay, going around the table. Brian?
Mike got most of my things answered. But it does bother me with the contracted services because I looked 2013, it was $25,000.
Mm-hmm.
Then we went up to 33.
Mm-hmm.
Then we went up to 60. Now we're at 100.
Yeah.
How much, and I know you probably can't answer this, but how much does it cost for one of these utilities litigation? Is there some kind of a rough average of how much these cost us?
Yeah, typically.
To go through this every year? Because that's what it seems to be. It's every year we're going to have to go through this. I didn't know if there was
We've settled them through this year, so we don't know if what's going to happen in 16 with the revaluation.
Right.
You know, but potentially, yeah, it could go on and on. I mean, I don't know that. Utility appraisals typically have been running between $20,000 and $25,000 for a report.
Okay, yeah, I just.
Yeah.
All right, I'm all set. Thank you.
Jimmy?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm troubled by this line item too, Ed. How you doing?
Good.
I went back 4 or 5 years here.
Mm-hmm.
You're averaging, I mean, going back to 2011, 12, 13, 14, well, from 2011 through 2014, you averaged $34,000 a year in that line item. And if you look, I think it's 2014 here.
Jerry, well, you'll look, and I'm just going to ask Ed a question. Ed, would you refresh me again? What year did we start taking funds out of the legal budget and directing them to your department?
I believe it was 2013.
Okay.
I believe that's correct.
Is it possible that going back before 2013, that expense showed up in legal?
Yeah, that's where I'm going.
I just want to clarify that because we changed, and I remember.
Right.
Money coming out of Mark's line and going in yours, which made him look great. And
we took some of Mark's that line item from Mark, which I don't remember. I think it might have been 20,000.
Mm-hmm.
Might have been the number.
It was when
we
boosted up to 60. So whatever it was prior to that.
Right.
Okay.
Well, whatever Mark's was prior to that became mine at 60. I think the 20 came from his line item. But
all
we
right.
made.
So it's no longer there, but prior to that, in prior years,
yeah,
you may only have been showing that expense before 2013 because some of that was coming out of Mark's budget, perhaps?
Oh, it was.
Yeah, all the bills for appraisal reports and all that expert testimony was going up to legal for them to pay. I didn't process any of that.
Jerry, I'll turn it back
to you. No, I mean, that's what makes me uncomfortable because Mark doubled. This year, from 15 to 16, he's doubled. He went from 25 to 50K for contracted services on the outside. And this line item shows up, and it almost looks like You know, and I don't want to, you know, cast suspicions or anything, but it almost looks like we lost the lawyer and we gave the one we lost line items to Ed.
Well, all I can say is my line item is to pay for expert reports and expert testimony. Any appraisals the town needs go through my budget. Attorney fees or any other type fees would go through legal, not through assessing. So I, you know, so I don't, I can't answer for Mark's budget, but this budget is
That's how it was separated out. You have the report piece.
Right, I hire the
appraisals. Legal is still done.
I hire the appraisals. Through my office.
Who hires the lawyers?
Oh, that would be Mark, not me.
Mark gets the lawyers, presents the legal side of things.
And he pays for that.
Who gets the special witnesses?
Well, the witnesses would be, again, my experts that do an appraisal report would be the witness to their appraisal report. That's
how
that works.
So you get the witnesses, and you have the appraisals and the witnesses of the appraisal, blah, blah, blah. He has the lawyers.
I have
the appraisal report. You have to show up with a lawyer, right, that is BTLA?
Well, Mark presents the trials for us, yes.
But this line item has taken off. And it may be just as you painted, the fact that it all came in on you, all of these things that were pending came in on you.
All at once this year. As you can tell by 13 and 14, we had some, but we were nowhere near the line item
I remember last year it was underspent. We sat here saying, well, none of them have landed, and they will eventually.
Now, do you have all your assessments done of the utilities?
For the revaluation?
No, I mean for gas or electric or water, and are those assessed?
Well, they're assessed through 2015.
Through?
They're not assessed for the revaluation.
So they have to be reevaluated?
Yes.
For 16.
Yeah.
Good. Curious.
Well, we have to value all properties anew, so that includes the utilities. We have no choice but to value those as well.
I'm curious on the lawsuits for the abatements. Has the town ever won?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think in a lot of these.
Put it on a balance, because you know when you're talking the utilities, they've got a big legal department, or a requirer's got a big legal department. You know their lawyers are paid all along. I'm just curious.
Yeah, I think the expert reports help in our negotiation.
Yeah, because I remember what happened with Seabrook last year.
But on a couple of these, we were able to negotiate settlements through 2015 based on the expert reports that supported.
Yeah, well, that's the ideal solution to work a compromise. Yeah.
It would be nice to win every one of them, but it's not going to happen.
So. The other question I have is, you're going through a reassessment. Properties that are selling, are they selling close to their assessed value, or are they above or below?
Well, we always look at a reval as a third of the properties go up, a third stay the same, third may go down a little bit. And some properties may, when we reconfigure all the grades and adjustments and stuff, but the market overall, though, is indicating. And we've looked at sales today, and we have 744 qualified sales that we are starting to review, and we have to look at sales through next April 1. So we're looking at potentially 1,000 sales. Today we looked at close to 100 sales, and I think...
You automatically, when a sale gets completed, you change the assessment? No, you don't.
No, we can't do that. We have to do it as part of a full townwide revaluation. We can't just adjust one sale at a time. But the sales are indicating that the values are increasing.
In 5 years from now, when you reassess,
Ed,
so far year to date, you've spent $279,000 in your budget.
Yes.
That annualizes out to $335,000 if it's a linear spend rate, which I don't know that it is. How much of that 279 spent year to date has been dedicated to the reevaluation effort?
Well, to
roughly. You just talked about contracted services, so that wouldn't be part of the reevaluation.
No, the reval is a is not part of this budget?
It is not part of, well, it is, you got regular wages, right? You got a guy there that you hired.
Well, we, our, the person we hired to do cyclical work.
Last year you hired, well, this year. You hired somebody for this year. I thought it was part of the eval.
Well, we're trying, yeah, the cyclical work is necessary to go to the properties that haven't been visited to make sure that the information is correct or more correct, so that everybody's treated fairly.
So, but I mean, is he laying the groundwork for the evaluation?
He's laying the groundwork for the data being correct.
Okay.
The revaluation is going to be done by myself and Vision.
Okay, but
that's the.
But is his work considered under the category of the reevaluation of 15, 16?
He was hired for the purpose of doing the cyclical work as part of to.
Did you need
to
that
help? Do we need it?
Did you need that as part of the evaluation?
Yes, we did.
So I think during the presentation last year, you did say that it was his role was going to be to help out on this reevaluation.
We did, well, yeah, the cyclical work, that's the helping.
So was he in this regular wages business?
He's under regular wages.
How much of that, about half of that or what?
No.
I'm trying to determine.
40,000, I think, 1850 an hour.
Okay, it's 40K or so.
Yeah.
What other line items here might have been bumped by due to the evaluation, if any?
Oh, nothing was. Actually, if you look, part-time went down, supplies went down, data processing basically stayed the same, but that was...
So basically, the operating budget is...
Everything's pretty much...
Is only that fellow we hired.
Yeah, and the increase in mileage, motor vehicle allowance, is necessary based on what I just told you about all the additional or larger amounts of work that have come, you know, through the office or through the town.
So... Okay, that's what I wanted to.
So, like I said, if you take the 40,000, I mean, for the increase we're looking for, the rest of the budget we're looking for $1,554.
Yeah. This has been an unusual year, Ed, in terms of these utilities and these marine
and
these
floss
manufacturers.
Well, it has, because if you look at my budget every year, we've never we've never reached our budget limit.
No, you're 30,000, 40,000.
Always 30,000, 40,000 below. This hasn't been it's been a busy year.
And you're asking next year for a big bite, too.
You know, give you a little comparison that I know it doesn't matter. But if you look at, let's take Seabrook, for example.
Yeah.
Their taxable value is $2.5 billion. Half of that's the Seabrook plan.
Yeah.
So their properties are valued at $1.25 billion.
Yeah.
They got 4,300 parcels. We got 9,000.
Yeah.
Their assessing budget's $300,000. So, I mean, for the amount of work and the limited staff, and I'm not, you know, I'm just saying, I think the number we have, I don't know how we can do it for anything less.
Yeah, well, we haven't gotten the other line item, but the contracted services, we haven't gotten to supplies and any of that stuff yet, so.
Yeah.
Which we want to get into.
But, I just don't know how we can do it for any less at this point.
I just had to get the feel. I didn't know how the evaluation effort was weighing in on this.
And
I think you've clarified that. I mean,
all right. I think we've killed this subject.
Yeah.
Anything else in this budget that anyone has a question on?
On wages, mm-hmm. when we're running through the end of October, 121,000, and so that annualizes to 145,000, and we're looking at 167,000. You know, in the budget. So is there, you know, the running rate for this year compared to the budget that we're asking for, is there a change of staffing? Somebody in a full?
It's just myself, Charlene, the two full-time staff, and the part-time, the contractor. I think we had a 1.5% increase in pay raise.
Yeah. It's just the actual numbers. When you take October's year-to-date, divide it by 10, multiply it by 12.
It should equal at the end. It always has. So
yeah,
I don't know.
It says it's a 50.
Your contractor guy didn't start till what?
Oh, April, that's right. The contractor. He didn't start till April.
Good.
We didn't. That's right. He didn't get on board till April.
Thank
so
you.
That was a little less because of that.
All
sorry.
Right.
Nice wiggle.
And then data processing. You mentioned Vision. I mean, we've spent $1,200 so far this year, but we're saying 12,000 in the budget. Is that, do we pay them at the, in the next couple of months?
Vision gets paid once a year for the, for the, for the large
okay, that, that
maintenance
bill,
of the camera system.
Okay, that bill must be coming up because
it did, and it went up, it actually went up like $150, like $53.50, something like that.
Yeah.
Also, in regards to sending out tax bills, we do pay for the postage. No, yeah. We pay for one thing. I think we pay for postage.
No, I think even the postage came out
what
of finance.
What do we pay for? When it, Joe, the printing of the bills. I'm sorry, we pay for the bills. Because the bills come, the warrant and comes from assessing to the tax collector, which means we take care of the actual tax bills. So we pay for those.
Yeah, it's through October, we've spent $1,020, and we're asking for $12,000. So there must be that big bill must be coming in November, December.
Also, the that and the GIS bill.
Okay.
For the It just came in for the online GIS.
Okay.
Canvas.
So, I want to understand this, Scott, a little bit better. You're right. He's spent $1,020 through October, and he's budgeting $12,000 for next year.
Right. The bills for both Vision, for Cartographic, which maintains our GIS mapping system, and you see that online. If
Vision.
Vision and
appraisal for the evaluation that's going to be taking place.
No, Vision appraisal. Every year we pay a fee to maintain. We have
the visual appraisal system.
The camera system. Yeah, maintenance of the camera system and the running of the camera system.
What is that roughly?
That's around 53. Well, it's gone. Goes up every year a little bit. It's around $5,300. I believe this year. I may have it here, but I.
53.50.
Yeah. 53.50.
And what was the other one? GIS. Did you say
GIS? Also, we have the online. Vision Online, which is, I believe, $2,750. Yeah.
Yeah,
Vision Online. All those things get paid once a year, and you typically at the end of the year. So we don't spend until we get those bills right at this time of year. And I believe Christy was right. Yeah, those bills just came in last week, so I received those bills last week.
So are you saying that by the end of the year you'll be...
That line item gets filled, yeah.
It does.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now you should start to see that in the actuals by the end of November.
Right. I just wanted to leave that with Scott. I wasn't totally comfortable yet.
Yeah.
Okay, I am more comfortable now. Thank you, Christy and Ed. Yeah, for data processing anyway.
All right. Two.
Supplies and expense, maybe we should let Brian handle that. He's a supplies and expense guy.
We're going to acknowledge Tim first because he had his hand up.
Sure.
Good evening, Ed.
Good evening.
You said that the tax bills are actually printed under your department and not tax collectors.
We pay for the printing.
We pay for the printing.
We produce the warrant, therefore we produce the tax bills, which are presented to the tax collector.
Is that a function of law that it's coming out of your...
It's in the RSA, correct.
So it's your responsibility to send out the tax bills?
Not to send them out.
To produce
the warrant, okay. Which is the tax bill. Yep.
Just wanted to get clear on that. Thank you very much, Ed.
You're welcome.
Jerry, did you want a supply question?
Yeah, I have a supply question. We budgeted $9,331 for 215. Year to date, we spent about $5,000.
Mm-hmm.
It annualizes out to about $6,700 if you do it linearly.
Mm-hmm.
You're now asking for $9,061. So this seems a little bit high to me. Compared to your 215 actuals to date, annualized out. Comment?
Yes. Some of those line items have to do with continuing education and mileage that relates to going to continuing education classes. I'm required to recertify in 2016. Although that line item, again, just like the other, doesn't get totally used each year, it is necessary on a yearly basis to have that line item for that purpose of education. That's one of the...
Well, as an expense in 2014, Ed, was $4,224.
Well, I mean, Jerry, all I can tell you is that we're not going
to
max that line out every
money.
Year. I'm not going to... But it's the line items that are in there are necessary. and potentially are necessary.
I'm just saying, if you actually spent in 2014, $4,000 essentially, and you were year-to-date in 15, would I say you were about...
The registry expense, let me go over the registry expense. That's there in case, we typically every month we'll get the deeds from the registry for the sales. However, if we have to record anything regarding renewed leases for the leased land, we have to record those, any barn preservation easements. Now, those aren't going to come up in the same amount every year. We may have one year, we may have seven the next year. We don't know each year. It's not going to be the same every year. So that's that one. Conference and education, has to do with continuing education, the New Hampshire Assessing Association meetings that I have to go to. The education will be spent more. Some of it's been spent this year. You'll see some more stuff coming through. Actually, we're going to be at a conference next Thursday, Friday in Manchester, and I have another class that I have to take in December.
Yeah, but you had the same array of expenses last year when you presented.
Right.
As you have this year. They're just the same, yep. The same line items. I looked at the same line items. And not big spent, that's all I can say. Yeah, looking at 14 and 15 year to date.
Right.
And looking at your array of expenses.
Right.
They were identical from last year to this year. That's my only comment. I hear what you're saying. Some come in on time, some don't.
Yeah, I mean, it's just not a line item that's going to be spent 100% every year.
I don't have the history of that line item. Scott, do you?
Yeah, it's 2011, it was $10,200.
Okay.
2012, $9,100. So going back,
what about
earlier years, you're right on. You know, but it's,
what about 13?
Dip down.
What about 13?
$6,800.
Trying to save money.
But I don't those were not those reevaluation years, though, were they?
What's that?
Those were not reevaluation years, though, were they?
No.
This is.
They were not certification years either. I have to right. I have to complete all that, you know, what's left.
So your supplies and expenses would probably vary in that case. So they're not truly comparable because of that. How much do you estimate the certification and reevaluation increases the supplies and expenses?
Well, you mean for my certification? I've got to complete a USPAP course, which is going to be around 300. I've got to do a state statutes one-day course. But also, we've got a two-day conference next week and the monthly meetings of the New Hampshire Association. So there'll be a meeting in December. I think that line item is probably going for next year is going to be right on that $1,500.
Just looking for a ballpark for a percentage increase that the reval and certifications increase your supplies and expense line. Just a gut feel.
I
won't hold it to you, I promise.
Well, I mean, what did we spend last year? Would you say $6,400 or something like that?
You don't really have a gut feel for that, then.
I'm not really sure. Yeah, it's hard to say.
No real gut feel. Okay, fair enough.
4,200 in 2014, yeah. But that was low.
It was low because the tax bills come out of that account. The tax bills,
right.
Something must be wrong because tax bills alone are going to be over 4,000.
You haven't paid for the tax bills yet.
No, I meant in 14. I was talking 14.
14, yeah. They're over $4,000.
Yeah, because there's another tax bill coming in, too, for the second set of bills.
Those don't vary year to year, though, except for inflation costs.
Yeah, I think
the same activity every
basically
year.
Basically, 2,000 and something each quarter or each half. Yeah.
Okay. Anyone else, Brian?
Got to get something in, I guess. On the supplies, I'm getting a little confused here because on the supplies and expenses, you said this is for your continuing education and mileage.
Well, under conference and education. Under conference and education. I use that line item for monthly assessor meetings, the yearly conference that'll be next week, and the mileage associated with that.
Right, and we also have a mileage account.
Well, that mileage is for in-town review, property review, cyclical work, sales review. That line item is used for that.
Okay.
I want to keep the account separate. Any mileage associated with a conference or education thing, I'm taking out of that line item.
So he has.
Yeah, no, I understand it. I just, because there's another one. And expense for the changes for the registry.
Right.
Easements. Isn't this included in the two line items as well?
You talking about registry expenses?
Yes.
What would be included? What are you asking? What's included?
It would be under their. I'm going to let that one pass. I'm going to have to check that one out.
Okay.
One other question, Ed. You all done? One other question. I don't see any gas allowance here, Christie, for this account or line item.
Mileage.
No, we do mileage, Jerry.
Doing mileage?
We do mileage instead. Because we use, they use their own vehicles.
Oh, you use your own vehicles.
Yes.
So is it the wonder you're not here asking for a brand new car?
Easy.
Okay, we're going to stop on that one. All right. I think we've killed.
Thanks, Ed.
We've killed this short list of things that we've always done a good job of keeping it in wrap. Thank you very much for joining.
Okay, appreciate it.
Okay, moving on, I'm going to move on to conservation. Jay Diener is with us from the Conservation Commission. Okay, so 53 in the book and OBS 22, I think. Good evening, Jay. How are you?
I'm doing fine. How are you?
Good.
Good evening, everybody. Before I get started, I wanted to thank the chair for moving me up on the agenda. I have a very early flight I have to catch tomorrow morning, so I appreciate any extra sleep that I can get this evening. So.
Oh, we should have.
Thank you very much for that.
Awesome. Should have put you last then.
Not like some of the old meetings when we're here till 11, but.
I'm sure you're all happy about that
we
as well.
We can dive right into this.
Sure.
I'll let you present what you have, and then if we have any questions, I'll go around the table again. Hands up, gentlemen. First.
Sure. I'm not going to go through every line item unless you'd like me to. We did provide a narrative to you as we were requested to do this year, which I believe is in your Appendix G that explains.
Now, I don't think you have that large a budget.
I don't think we do either.
Okay, here. So if we didn't go through every line item, we wouldn't be talking about anything, unfortunately.
Okay.
So a lot of times people listening to it for the first time, because there are people who listen to the budget committee who don't listen to other presentations. So since it's short, if you could go over them with us.
Sure. First item is part-time wages for our conservation coordinator, and we are asking for a 1.5% increase in those wages for next year. The second item is public outreach, and what that includes is programs like our painted rain barrel auction and other items, other programs that we have in town to try to help people understand how they can work with us to improve water quality, improve drainage on their properties. Secretarial expenses, we're looking to increase that this year as well. We're looking for a $1 an hour increase in those wages. We asked for that again last, we asked for that last year, but of course the budget didn't pass last year. That amount has not changed since sometime in the early 2000s. I went back as far as 2002, and it was at $10 an hour at that point. I think a $1 an hour increase is warranted for that. Postage and supplies are that. We do mailings to new homeowners who move into town who have wetlands on their property. We do mailings to permit holders whose permits are about to expire. We do other mailings to people in town, and so that covers those postage and paper supplies. Professional services, We, upon occasion, need to, most of the time when we ask for an independent delineation of wetlands, we will have the applicants pay for those if it's on their property. The state allows us to do that. But there are times that we have to bring people in to help educate us on the finer points of wetlands delineation, because it is becoming a more complex science, and we're finding that we need to be a lot more knowledgeable than we once were about how these delineations are done, what the criteria are, what Army Corps manuals are being used for the delineation. So we have to get more into the details, so that helps us to learn more about that. Seminars that are put on by the state, by DES, by other organizations that help us understand more about what's going on in our salt marsh, in our estuary, in our wetlands around the town. Computer supplies and office equipment, exactly what it says. Our camera just broke, so we need to invest in a new camera. We photo document all the properties that where work is being done for our commission, so we've got a record of exactly what was accomplished there. Mileage reimbursement is for programs that we go to, as well as for the site walks that we do on a monthly basis. Green infrastructure projects includes things like our Soak Up the Rain program that we've initiated, where as it is right now, we are issuing grants to homeowners and businesses in Hampton to help install rain gardens on their properties. We're also hosting seminars so people can learn more about what a rain garden is, how it functions, and how it can be beneficial on their properties. So it's programs like that that come under the Green Infrastructure Program. And that's it.
Okay. Questions?
Nope.
Now,
his supply is an expense year to date. He's not spending anything.
Is that a question, mm-hmm. Jerry?
Yes.
Okay.
I mean, I don't think you saw me.
I'm sorry.
You've only, you spent $511 through September. I don't know what the, I guess it's $645 through October. And the budget is $4,330. Can you explain that, please?
Most of what we spend for office and supplies, and I'm surprised it's as low as it is, it should be higher than that, because it's ink for our printer, and paper supplies is most of what we spend on it. Like I said, we need to invest in a new camera, so that will come out of that budget. We bought a new printer a couple of years ago, that came out of that budget. So we're not going to spend it every year, but we don't know when those expenses are going to arise. We didn't know when we were presenting last year's budget that our camera was going to break.
Yeah. I'm looking at 11 and 12, and it's about $4,800, $4,400, $3,813, $4,114. Looks like you just took a nosedive this year. Yeah. I mean, you were averaging just about what you're budgeting. What you budgeted for this year, but you've only spent $645, so unless the money's been mislocated or mispositioned.
I don't think so. We hope not.
Well, it is what it is.
Yeah.
$645 through October. And you've budgeted, and previous years, you're right, you know, it's $4,800, $4,400, $3,841. And you budgeted $4,330. You haven't spent much. You got a lot in the bank for yourself. And my other question is on part-time wages. It seems to me you're budgeted for $28,290 right now for 15. Yeah. So $28,290. This is $29,240. Okay. Is that 1.5?
We're at $28,802 currently.
And I know. Well, the budget for 15
yeah,
is
budget is
right.
$28,290. So what does that come out? Is that 1.5? 29,240 minus 28,290 is $950. Divided by 28,290 is 3.35%.
Our conservation coordinator did receive a mid-year increase this year.
Oh, this year?
This year.
Oh, so the budget was incrementally increased, or what? I don't know.
The increase this year took her up to 28,802. So what we're using that as our baseline and asking for a 1.5% increase for next year. They'll take it up to 29,240.
I missed that mid-year stepper.
So that we're clear on that. So for 2015, she got 1.5, and you're proposing 1.5 again for 2016. This position came into being, I believe, in the latter part of 2011?
I believe it was 09.
Christy, was it 09 or 2011? Do you know that this position came in?
I know Rayanne was not the first person to hold the position.
Yeah, because in 2013, it was almost a 10% raise. So if you go 2013 at 10% to 2015, or 2016, a very short period, you're looking at 13% raise in that position over that period of time. That is well in advance of other positions for non-union individuals. Matter of fact, even union or non-union.
Excuse me, I don't have the numbers in front of me, but I think if you look at the salary as it was in 2009 and compare that to what we're for next year, then it's entirely different story.
We don't do that. We don't go back all that way, because certainly we have individuals and unions and otherwise who went years and there was no catch-up. And what I'm trying to see is how you personally are tracking your own employees at a rate that is not way in advance of what's going on for all of the personnel, union and non-union alike.
We're working pretty hard to try and keep it at the same rate, to try and keep it at a 1.5% rate per year.
Every year?
We're trying to. The problem that we have is that the budget doesn't pass, the voters don't pass the budget. And in 17 years, it's passed four times.
Well, we realize that, and when that happens, unfortunately, personnel and union, non-union alike, don't see their increases. And that's unfortunate. It doesn't mean that as we go forward, it means voters didn't vote that increase that year. It doesn't mean that when you get to the next year, you double down, because that creates them going back to the polls and saying no again. So just a little thought there in that one. And also on the part-time wages, I see we're increasing an individual from $10 an hour to $11 an hour.
Correct.
And that's a 10% increase. And you say that person has been with us since 2002. The scope of the work that person does?
Didn't say that person has been with us since 2002. I said that position has not had an increase since 2002.
Mm-hmm.
And what that person does is keep the minutes for every public hearing that we have.
Okay. And I'll just throw out real life experience this year. The budget committee finally gave an increase to a position that hadn't been increased in 15 years.
But we're pretty close to that.
But it's not the same person, correct? How long has this person had that position?
This person has had the position for less than a year.
Okay, and they don't get a flat rate per meeting, they get an actual hour. So they're less than a year?
Less than a year.
So they accepted the position at $10, and a year later, you're giving them a 10% increase.
What I'm saying is that the position warrants
25%
an increase. We, as the Conservation Commission, have asked for pretty detailed minutes for our meetings.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of work involved.
I don't doubt that. There is a lot that has to go into it. I'm just saying the position was offered out there at one rate, and 1 year later, the increase is for 10%. It was requested for 10%. Did that person receive a mid-year increase?
They did not.
They did not. Okay. Only the other part-time position received a mid-year increase.
That's correct.
Okay. And I just have one other question and one point of clarity. when it comes to, and I'm looking for the exact line. Give me one second here. Deposit to the Conservation Land Fund. Is that the money that is left over in your account at the end of the year, if you have money left over?
No. We have, that line item has been on the budget for as long as I've been on the commission, and probably longer ago than that. And there was a period of time when we were asking for $1 annually just as a placeholder, if you will. In fact, the funds that go to that, to the Conservation Land Fund, come from warrant articles, where we ask for that money if the voters choose to support those warrant articles, and from change of use fees. Which was also approved by a warrant.
I somehow think deposit to the Conservation Land Fund, because we have so many different funds and so many different things. Some of this is new to me, too, so help me out here.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't really say what it is based on the explanation you just gave of the monies that go into it. And I guess I need a little clarity, because the Conservation Commission works a little bit different than the town budget insofar as when you come to the end of the year, whatever is left over in your budget rolls into which fund?
Conservation Fund.
Conservation Fund.
It's the Conservation Fund. Okay. So, just using round numbers, if your budget was $10,000 and you spent $9,500 and you had $500 left, it would not go into the unreserved funds. It would go into the Conservation Fund for your use at your discretion. Correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Just need clarity on that. Now, when we talk about Land Acquisition Fund, because that's thrown out, is there a separate Land Acquisition Fund in itself?
We have changed the name. It used to be called the Land Acquisition Fund, but by specific definition, those funds were to be used for acquisition and maintenance of conservation land. Having the word acquisition in the name of the fund created some confusion, so we've just changed that name to the Conservation Land Fund.
The Conservation Land Fund, so going back to the Conservation Fund. So now there's one fund that deals with all of it. So it's now the Conservation Land Fund. But the Conservation Land Fund. I got a couple of questions, but I just want to be clear, so bear with me. The Conservation Fund was coupled with the Land Acquisition Fund. Now we have one fund called the Conservation Land Fund that is for acquisition, but also maintenance and any programs that Conservation Commission deems worthy. And that those funds never go back to the general fund once they're given to the Conservation Commission. Have I got that link okay?
The Conservation Land Fund, Conservation Commission Land Fund monies are only used for the acquisition of conservation land through outright purchase or the purchase of conservation easements and the maintenance of those properties. That is all the funds. Those are the only purposes that those funds are put towards.
Okay, so you couldn't take wages out of that particular fund or?
Nope.
That's it. All right, so then I have the other question I have is you change that from the Land Acquisition Fund, because somewhere I've gotten lost. I thought I was funding Land Acquisition Funds.
You are funding Land
Acquisition. Well, it's changed a little bit. When did that change, and who changed it?
It changed last year. The Conservation Commission changed it. What changed was the name of the fund, not the usage of the fund. The usage of the fund, the description of what that fund could be used for, always included maintenance of conservation lands. That has not changed.
As well as acquisition?
As well as acquisition. The only reason for the change of the name of that fund is because a lot of people assumed that because the name of the fund said acquisition only, that the monies in that fund could not be used for maintenance. We changed the name of the fund to have it more accurately reflect what the monies in that fund were used for.
Is there some place where the land acquisition fund was spelled out that it was for maintenance as well as acquisition? Or was
and
it a gray area?
The fund was created, I believe it was in 1985 at town meeting. That's how it was spelled out. That's how it was described. It was to
1885? 1985. 1985. I'm sorry.
Hey,
I'm getting old.
That's close.
Oh, God. So there's only one fund then, right?
Yes.
One fund.
There's only one fund.
It's called now the Conservation Commission.
Nope.
Conservation Commission Land Fund. The Conservation Commission Land Fund is only used for the acquisition of conservation properties and the maintenance thereof.
Okay.
We don't take monies from that fund for any other purpose.
What revenue stream into there? Where you get the, how does that fund build?
By
warrant articles.
By warrant articles, by change of use fees, and in at times in the past, through gifts. We've had money donated for that fund twice in the past.
Mm-hmm. What's the name of that fund again? Can
no,
you do it one more time? I'm going to write
that,
it down.
Mike, I just want to... It's also the residual that's left out of your budget at the end of the year would go into that fund.
That does not go into the land fund.
It does not go into.
Does not go into the land.
So there is two separate funds that
we're. No, it goes into the undesignated fund balance is what I think he's driving at. Right.
No, it doesn't.
No, it doesn't.
No, it doesn't.
Doesn't go into
it stays the statute. It goes into the conservation fund.
Okay. Exactly.
Right. So if we only have one,
so there are two funds. There are two funds.
There are two funds.
Well,
in the beginning, I thought there were one. Now there's two. Maybe tomorrow there'll be three. What do you think, Phil?
Now there are two.
You know what? Hey, gentlemen, we're asking him questions. Let's give him the floor. Thank you.
My understanding was that people were asking if there was a conservation land fund and a conservation land acquisition fund. That question, I was saying, no, there is one fund, which is the conservation land fund.
Okay.
Okay.
That's one.
Then we have our conservation commission, if you will, general fund, separate and distinct.
That's not on this list of funds.
That's because we keep it.
Madam Chair.
Right.
All right. I've ported this session. I'm going to turn over to Tim for questions and anyone else.
I'm going to try to get this clear in my mind, so help me, okay? We have two funds.
Right.
One is the conservation fund.
Right.
That's the name. Do you know how much money is in that fund?
I don't know off the top of my head.
Would you like to take a guess?
You know?
Off the list of funds that we received, Tim, it was, as of 9:30, was $135,450.
Exactly right.
How much again, Nick?
$135,450.
Right. Thank you.
Now, that fund, according to statute, because the statute reads that conservation, the town may create a conservation fund. Do you have a question, Jay?
Can you excuse me?
Sure.
This is very opaque, to say the least.
Which is why we need to ask.
I want to know what's being made.
Sorry. Do you have some wisdom you'd like to share?
Nobody knows.
No, continue, please.
Okay, you're going to keep it secret. Okay. We have a conservation fund, which, according to statute, the town can create a conservation fund, and when the town does create it, it's under the authority of the Conservation Commission.
Correct.
Right. The Conservation Commission is appointed, not elected.
Correct.
And they need no one's permission to take money out of that fund, except the Conservation Commission's majority vote, which constitutes three members, right?
No, four.
Four. Let's hope you don't have a tie, I guess. Now, the other fund, which was at one point in time called the Land Acquisition Fund, do you know how much money is in that?
We have, I believe, 60 some odd thousand that is available funds.
Okay.
$60-some-odd thousand, so add those two funds together, and you got $200-some-odd thousand in the two funds that are under your control.
Can I just, I don't want to get too far. Just don't, hold, stay on the air and hold.
I'm summarizing, so hopefully I'll get right to where you're going, okay?
To the 108?
108.
108.
Where is that?
I watched the clip.
Okay.
And there was the 108, 46 allotted part of the cost for Ice Pond, and approximately 60,000 left.
Well, but that's a warrant article. That doesn't go into the land fund.
No. That's part of the fund.
No, she's referring to your presentation at the Board of Selectmen where you mentioned $108,000, but I believe that referred to the Ice Pond warrant article money. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Right. We're not talking about those. We're talking about funds.
He's going to answer that, though.
We have wisdom from behind you?
We have wisdom from behind me.
Okay, excellent. Glad someone's got your back, Jay.
Our total fund balance is roughly $135,000.
For the land acquisition?
Both funds.
Wait a minute. We have a report from the finance director saying one fund, Conservation Commission fund, for $135,450. Is there needing a correction to this, Christy?
It's my understanding that the treasurer holds the Conservation Commission fund, and within that fund, she has a breakdown, which I do not have for you, so I can't tell you how it is broken down.
Right.
But it's broken down by her, and I believe that what we're now referring to as the Conservation Land Fund, as instead of the Land Acquisition Fund, is included in that Conservation Commission fund that the treasurer has listed on the list of funds that you receive.
So it's kind of like double mint gum. It's two funds in one.
I believe it's broken down even further, to be completely honest with you, but I don't have the breakdown. But I am under the impression that the Conservation Land Fund is included in that what the treasurer is referring to as a Conservation Commission fund. And at the end of the year, whatever is left in their budget does go to the treasurer, like the chairwoman has.
Right, goes to the treasurer,
goes
but
to
under
the
which
treasurer,
fund?
The conservation
fund. What I'm hearing is from you is that the treasurer is commingling the two funds into one fund.
I do not believe they are commingled. I believe she has them listed out.
Then why didn't she report them out separately to you?
I don't know.
They have different uses.
I believe they have different uses, therefore she keeps the amount separate so that
asked her, when you generated this report, you asked the treasurer.
Because she considers it the Conservation Commission.
So in her mind, she's commingling it. Maybe she is in her books or not, we don't know. But at least in her mind, she is commingling it.
I think that it's not commingled if she has it spelled out on paper in her office. I would disagree with that.
Why don't we get clarification on that?
Yeah.
Let's get clarification
We need to get from her.
We have just gotten new light on the matter, and I appreciate it. Thank you, Christy. So, we've gone as far as we can on that point. Yeah. But it seems as though some official minds, treat the two funds as one, and occasionally, depending on the circumstances, others do not.
You know, my thinking is that surplus money that he doesn't spend in his budget comes over to here. Why can't that be used for raises, for instance?
Well, the conservation fund, according to statutes, can be used for any purpose consistent with the Conservation Commission's activities, regardless of what those activities are.
Right.
So, theoretically, that's correct. But
it sounds like there's an acquisition and maintenance part of this branch, and another branch, to me, it's a general thing that could be used for things like raises.
Right. Yeah, well.
And other expenses.
We still got the double mint gum problem to deal with.
Right. We've got to get
a certainly the conservation
that.
Fund under statute affords the suggestion that you were putting forth. Okay?
Yes.
So, reclaiming my time.
Christy, if we could.
If I could.
Officially ask the clarification of the two funds, how they're listed, and the differentiations between use. And I think it's important to bring that up, because as we're talking about dams and maintaining dams, where the maintenance would lie, and if personnel cannot be covered in these items, where the personnel would fall on.
Madam Chair?
That's a good question.
Can we claim my time?
You can. I just wanted to follow
that
through.
Thank you for that clarification. Yeah, I appreciate that.
I think the personnel issue is a good issue, and if it belongs in either one of these, because clearly somebody will have to maintain the dams if and when they're ever
But the ice pine dam.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
You're welcome, sir.
Jay, you mentioned that the formerly known land acquisition fund was created by a warrant article in 1985.
I believe it was 85.
And that, therefore, was created by the voters of the town, the ultimate legislative authority in the town, the voters. Mm-hmm. In that warrant article, did it authorize the Conservation Commission to change the name of the fund as it saw fit?
Specifically, no.
Then how did the Conservation divine that it had the authority to change the name of a fund that the local legislature, the town voters, said, this is the name? How did the Conservation Commission divine the authority to make that change?
Our intention was only...
Didn't ask about your intent. How did you divine that it was in your authority to do so?
We didn't know that we didn't have the authority.
Oh, so you assume you have the authority unless someone tells you do not. Is that correct?
In this particular instance?
Thank you. No more questions, Madam Chair.
Does anybody else have a question?
I do. Okay, Steve, go ahead.
I watched the selectmen's meeting, and there was... Define something that's being maintained. Are we going to be talking about that dam? Is that where, that what maintenance we're talking about?
Right now, that is, fortunately, most of the properties that the town owns require little, if any, maintenance.
Okay.
The town owns the ice pond and the ice pond dam through the Conservation Commission.
Right. What other things do you maintain as a conservation committee?
Trails.
Okay.
There's really not much else. This is really the first time any significant expense item for maintenance has come before us, certainly as long as I've been on the commission, because, as I said, most of our other properties are just open spaces. There are no structures. There are no facilities on them. There are no bridges. There are no dams on any of the other properties. So maintenance is almost negligible. It requires cleaning up trails and maybe unclogging stream beds, which is something that we can do on our own or with volunteer help.
Right.
The dam is a different ballgame. Obviously, we don't have the ability to build a dam.
Right, but, and now, you're appointed, as well as two other conservation committee people, correct? You're appointed, you don't get paid, correct?
Well, we only have one paid employee. Everybody
right.
else on the commission is appointed, correct?
Yeah, and you get the same pay as we get.
Exactly.
Okay, now, when I listened to the meeting Monday, the little segment that I listened to, I heard you talking about the maintaining the dam with some of this money. Because there was a warrant article last year for $90,000 that passed.
Correct.
To fix the dam.
Right.
And I think from what I gathered from the meeting Monday with the selectmen, you weren't able to get to that project at all. Is that correct? So the $90,000 is still sitting there.
Correct.
And it's going to have to be another warrant article because it wasn't. What is the word? It runs out.
It lapses.
It lapses. Right.
That's
it's not non-lapsing. Okay. Have you used some of this money to do something with that dam this year?
Only work with an engineering firm that we hired through bidding process to design the dam for us.
Wouldn't that come out of the $90,000 versus this
money? No, that came out of Conservation Commission funds.
I don't understand why. I mean,
the $90,000 was is to rebuild the dam.
Right. So that
it did not include the engineering work for the dam.
As a person that voted for that, I thought it included the $90,000.
Thought it was a wraparound.
Yeah, that was the cost. I didn't realize that you were going to be taking money, you know, that there was only partial cost, and then more, you know, whatever would be taken out of this money. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that as a voter last year.
Jay, was that money?
So that's news to me.
I'm sorry about that. I thought we made it pretty clear that the estimates that we got for the cost from the engineering firm for the cost to rebuild the dam was about $130,000. We were asking the voters for 90, and we're going to make up the difference from the conservation.
Out of one of these funds, okay.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Was that money spent to the engineering firm prior to the vote that approved repairing the dam?
Some of it was.
Okay, so in other words, it was a decision by the commission to expend the funds for that engineering review prior to the project being confirmed by the voters.
But there's nothing wrong with that, Madam Chair.
No, wait, wait.
I didn't say anything was wrong. I'm just trying to be clear.
They have the authority to do that.
With their funds.
Right.
Okay, can I finish now? Mm-hmm. So the Conservation Land Fund is used to acquire and maintain, and then the Conservation Fund, what is that used for?
Other purposes for the Conservation Commission, other projects that we have, other things that we are looking to pursue on the behalf of the town.
Okay. That's dictated by statute. Any activity defined under the Conservation Commission, any activity can be used, they can use the Conservation Fund money to do that.
Okay.
And that includes hire 1,000 employees if they want.
Well, that's what I'm asking. Yes. You basically can do whatever, you know, but it's under RSA, and it says that's correct. That's what, and is the Conservation Committee. Okay.
But it also says the question to your maintenance question. Think about maintenance of real estate, but there are other requirements in the statute regarding maintenance. For example, there's a requirement to maintain an index of all open space and natural, aesthetic, or ecological areas, with the plan of obtaining information pertinent to proper utilization of such areas, including lands owned by the state. Is that index available to the public?
Yes.
Great.
I don't know that it, yes it is.
It is. How might the public go about getting access to it?
Call the conservation coordinator.
Call the conservation coordinator, okay.
929-5808.
And are there plans for the proper utilization of, for example, Hampton State Park, which this clearly says it includes lands owned by the state?
We're indexing lands by the state. Obviously, we don't make decisions on how those lands are to be used because
no,
we don't own
them. No, it refers to with a plan of obtaining information pertinent to the proper utilization. So do you have plans regarding the proper utilization of what is indexed, specifically Hampton Beach State Park?
No.
Because it might be improper by some people's view to use town money to fund certain activities taking place there. Okay. But others might differ on
that. With all due respect, Madam, is this really budget related on...
Yes, it is.
Is it? Mm. So on what he has for indexes and whether or not he has the proper index, is this, we're grilling him on his job performance much more than we're asking budgetary questions.
Excuse me, I do not think that's an accurate characterization.
Excuse me, 1 minute.
There's no one grilling.
Jim, 1 minute, and I'll answer that.
So I think that he's being grilled on his job performance much more than we're spending time asking him about his budget. Maybe the budget was a little confusing at the point. I think we've taken the proper amount of time to understand that. But I don't think this is the forum to start asking him who we should consult and do you have the index and I don't know what that has to do with our budget. I know we're trying to stay firm on asking budgetary questions,
yes,
so we can move these around.
You asked,
but I think we're going out a little bit.
But you asked me a question.
Mm-hmm.
Let me answer you.
I'm waiting for it.
It seems a little far-reaching. However, it's not, because it involves two funds that, as we sat here tonight, no one at this table, including myself, could clearly define because they've been changed.
But we've done that.
Now, going forward, we have warrant articles that will be proposed.
We're not discussing warrant articles, though, right?
We're talking about...
We've made that very clear. We're not discussing warrant articles tonight.
Are you going to let me answer your question that you asked me to answer?
Well, I don't know.
In its entirety, or do you want to just...
Maybe I'll just keep going, because that seems to be the leadership role, that we just interrupt people and we just keep going, so...
Mm-hmm. Excuse me, Madam Chairman. I think this is getting a little off of the normal
path. I do,
too.
Madam Chair, point of order. The budget that we are discussing is attached to these funds, in that any surplus from the budget goes into the funds. So therefore, the budgetary conversation naturally would include the funds. Okay?
I get that.
And of course, whether we're properly spending money in areas that are consistent with the law is, of course, a proper conversation and a duty of our oath of office, I know that.
Should we read the whole RSA?
No, I'm not reading it. This whole RSA is multiple pages long.
I know, so...
And I have no intention of doing that. I am only pointing out that there's supposed to be an index. I don't think most people know there's supposed to be an index that's produced. And the gentleman just answered me that such an index is available, and I was simply asking him whether or not that index also includes, as law requires, that there be information pertinent to the proper utilization of those indexed areas. And I don't believe I got an answer, did I?
Well, you asked about a specific property, and I...
Well, I was using that as an example, but I was asking broadly.
Tim, he gave you an answer to that.
What was the answer, Madam Chair?
The answer was no.
No,
there is no pertinent information relative to proper utilization of the areas we've indexed.
I'm going to move on.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's a small department. It's two accounts. $27,000 one year, $30,000, you know, it's varied marginally over the last 5 years. I think we should move on.
Mm-hmm. That is your opinion, and yet...
I'll second that.
Prior to that, there wasn't any money that was given in the budget, so it's growing, and how the growth is put forward. Of particular interest to me, and should be to the rest of you, is that when the warrant articles were passed last year for maintenance of the dams, that did not fall on DPW. It fell here. And the questioning about all these funds, about where everything is, about the places that personnel can be paid from, I go back to the year that we had the Mother's Day floods. We've been blessed the past couple of years. It's been dry. But if we have a wet season and we have a pond that has been reconstructed, we will need someone to maintain the gates on the pond. That is an expense. And I just want to know from now where I should look for that. What fund? And as I'm sitting here, I'm finding out that these funds have changed, and I'm sorry if it's taking some of members' time and they don't appreciate it, but that's what this committee does, is it defines where the things are and how they're used. And if it's money that is raised by the public, where it goes. So I apologize to anyone who doesn't have the patience to have it explained. Thank you.
I might add to that. I mean, if these funds or a part of the funds can be used for maintenance, why didn't we pay the $90,000 to build the ice pond dam out of the general fund here? Or why, if we're going to give raises to somebody that works in the Conservation Commission, why don't we pay for it out of the surplus going into it on a yearly basis? So I'm not sure now what to do with this budget.
Those are really management questions.
Yeah.
So
that's
I would point out that in addition, Scott, to the relatively small budget number that we see every year, you know, we've got multiple hundreds of thousands of dollars in funds that are tied or associated with this. Mm-hmm. So while the appearance is small when you look at this piece of paper, it's a much bigger animal. And it's even bigger than that, isn't it, Jay? How many millions have we spent acquiring property rights in the last few years? And do you have a balance sheet as to the value of those property rights we now hold, just as a to kind of give us an idea of the enormity of the Board of Selectmen's task in protecting the town's assets?
Most of the funds that we have spent of late to acquire properties have been to acquire conservation easements on properties.
Right, and those are land rights. So what would you guess? I mean, how many millions are we talking about?
Very far.
I don't know.
Okay. See, Scott, it's much bigger animal than it looks on the surface.
Okay.
Trying to get a budget reviewed and passed.
I know. I'm trying to bring light on issues where there has been perpetual shade.
All right. Thank you all. I'm going to move on from this.
Helping the Board of Selectmen protect the town's assets.
Madam Chair, obviously we have some general questions. Multiple people have the same questions.
Yeah.
I say, let's put those questions on paper. send them to the TM. He can disseminate them accordingly, and we will get results back, hopefully answers to our question. Give everybody time to research them.
I agree.
The town manager has no authority on the Conservation Commission.
None. Zero authority on the Conservation Commission.
He can disseminate the questions to get the answers where we can put them.
The only place we can put them is the Conservation Commission.
Then he will direct them to him, and he can research them and get back to us.
Directing to him right here.
Gentlemen.
Let's put them on paper.
Madam Chair.
Okay, put them on paper.
By all means.
What time's your flight?
He missed it already. All right.
You suggested we all join him so we could follow up with that question?
We'll get our questions to the treasurer.
If you have questions, send them to me. I'll send them to the appropriate places. Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Thank you, Nick. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hey, thanks for coming in. I hope you don't feel grilled.
And have a good flight.
Yes, have a good trip.
Nice trip. Thank you.
The turbulence started before the flight.
It should be smooth sailing the rest of the way.
Okay.
Yeah, where were we and how did we get here?
Municipal debt, I think, is next.
What do I get left here? Anything?
Municipal debt.
Revenues, I believe, is next.
Revenue and long-term debt.
No, we haven't done debt yet, Steve.
That's D. C, which is what we're on, is revenue.
Tim.
Unless Madam Chair is going to change the agenda.
All right. Christie, want to join us?
Which one are we going to do now? Revenues?
Fred, feel free to come down, too. We don't want you to come all back there.
Okay, where are we?
And I have a question. Do we have a notification problem with the trustees that they did not know that tonight was their night?
Revenues?
I don't think so. I don't know. Do you know that they were notified?
I believe that the schedule was
went out to them as well.
Disseminated.
Okay.
They traditionally do not show at the budget hearings.
I'm sorry?
They traditionally have not shown at the budget hearings.
No, they show.
Not very often.
Last year, they wanted that money for the...
Yeah, they show up.
It's another one of those tiny little budgets.
Let's put it this way. They don't have a choice. We ask them to come. This is budget workshop.
What is the
D1? They were here last year for the budget, right. And they won. Yeah.
I will, at this point, call it a snafu that they are not with us tonight, and if it's okay with everyone, I will personally extend an invitation to them in another schedule.
I'm okay with that, Madam Chair, but I want to add that I have no desire for them to be here because I have no questions for them.
At all. Me either. I don't think there's any need for them to be here.
All right, then let me ask this. Is there anyone at this table who has a question for them, or do we... Is it a question that can be requested on paper or in presence?
I can swing that one.
All right.
I can swing.
Okay, so if it is all right with everybody, we will not have the trustees, and any questions will go to them.
I'm glad they didn't show up.
Pending Brian getting an adequate answer to his question.
I mean, I looked at their budget.
I don't mind that, but
mind-boggling.
I'm really kind of a stickler with... transparency and emailing, and I really think that if there are questions being asked and there's being responses, that is brought back to this table and the questions are read with the responses.
It is.
So everybody and the public knows what's going on.
It is, correct. And Sandy, I don't know if you were here for the meeting when we decided it only takes one person to decide that they don't want to let somebody out of the session. We've identified a few people that either their budgets were absolutely flat, there was no reason to come and sit here for 2 hours for nothing. Unless any one member here, didn't have to be a majority, decided otherwise that they would like that person to come. So we've left that caveat in. That's why I said to Brian, you know, will he be satisfied with the question on paper? Our intent this year is not to elongate the day of those who've worked hard all day when they might be.
We've done a good job so far.
We've elongated.
Yeah, we're not done. okay.
Okay.
All righty.
Next, Madam Chair.
Yeah. I got so excited I lost my agenda. Revenues.
Revenues.
D1.
D1.
Okay, no, this is usually just all good news, so.
Revenues, right?
Yep.
Revenues and debt service, so. Appendix C. I'm sorry? Appendix C.
Fred, we haven't welcomed you yet. May I do the honor and welcome you this evening?
Thank you, sir.
Set up by a Lord.
Appendix D.
Yes, Steve.
Good evening. Happy birthday, Madam Chairman.
Oh, my goodness. Not till tomorrow. Thank you. Thank you very much. And now, for the second time in 15 years, I'm totally beet red, so I hope you can keep your heads down.
It's a sign of youth.
Yeah.
Sign of vigor.
Okay.
Christy, I'm going to turn this over to you, okay?
And I'll turn it back over if anyone has any questions.
Yeah.
The revenues are in. They are up 2.9% from the 15 budget. I think it's important for everyone to remember that these are just estimates, and before we set the tax rate, we are required by the DRA to re-estimate our revenues, and so at that time, we get a better grasp on it. We also receive from DRA at that point the amount that we will be receiving for the highway block grant, rooms and meals, and all of those figures are given to us during the tax rate setting process. So you can see, if you look on D5, you can see that the budget for 2015 for the revenues was $6,867,196.
Right.
And then you also see another column where it says MS4. Mm-hmm. I think it's actually a 434 now. They've changed all their numbers. Mm-hmm. But as of 9/115, the revenues went up to $7,279,952. So that's the actual amount of revenue that was used when they were setting the tax rate. So obviously that helped to offset the increase in the tax rate. So. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you, Christy.
Around the table, any questions?
No.
For the other 13 people sitting at this table. Is there any questions, not only on the amounts, because this revenue is money in, it's not, we almost don't have much we can do about money that comes in other than be happy about it. Is there any questions about any of the lines themselves that you either don't understand or want more clarity on where they come from?
Let me just throw out some thoughts that I have. Is there anything we can do, Fred? Are we charging properly, in your opinion, for building inspection permits, you know, in terms of trying to recoup advance time at all, and fire inspection permits? I can't see those. Where are they, by the way? They should be in here.
They're up on page D1, or actually that's where the fire permits are. The building is on
page D2. D1, okay, I got you. Yeah, fire.
Both of those were just reading.
Where is fire, by the way?
It's on D1.
Yeah.
Under business licenses and permits, or under license permits and fees is the big box.
Right. Permits and fees.
FD permits is the second line there.
Fire department, right. Yeah. Yeah. I mean.
And they've been increased.
Substantially.
Yeah, yes. Right.
I could see that.
And the revenue reflects that.
Because
from $4,900 to $8,600.
You know, a man goes out, he spends a lot of time, not only that, but he's got to do a lot of documentation, probably before to go out, and when he's out, and then when he comes back, I'd like to think that we're recouping the man's time, and I don't know how close we are close to doing that.
They just reassessed those fees last year, or this year, I think, right?
Right.
They just changed those fees this year.
Well, I'm just saying that would be a place that I would really take a hard look at. Same thing with the building, you know, our Kevin going out and with his people, building permits. I don't mean to try to gouge anybody, but what is the rest of the marketplace out there charging for fire inspection permits? And and the building permits and making sure.
We're not on the top, but we're in the top third.
In terms of charging. On the building permits, I see that there's just an estimate there, so we didn't have a current due date at the end of September.
In your October financials, the revenue budget doesn't have any actuals in it. On your financials, building permits in October were at, oh, they're on a different page in here, let's see. They're on the, your first page, they're at $268,674 to date for the end of October.
Okay.
So I don't, that's really in the hands of the selectmen and Fred to discuss those things and decide if they're.
There's nothing we can do other than to look at them.
They were both reevaluated within the last year, though, is what I'm saying.
I have a question.
For building and for fire.
Christie.
Both of the fees.
Steven?
I see that account 8020, Rye Sewer Agreement.
Yes.
Now, didn't the Northampton State Park bathroom hook into the?
Yeah.
Was it the Rye?
Force main. It was a North.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right, it's right on the roof.
Because I see that.
1A.
You know, your budget at $80,000, it's, the estimate's $106,000.
The $106,000 is what was used for the tax rate, so.
Right, exactly, the revised estimate, yeah. But that's where that money would show up, is that one line right there.
Not from Northampton, no. It'd show up on that line because it's all billed to Rye. Rye then billed Northampton.
Oh, okay, okay, I understand now. And the other question is the dispatch for fire and police. We dispatch for Hampton Falls, correct?
We do.
And where is that in this? I looked and I couldn't find it.
It is on page D3.
Uh-huh.
If you look under income from departments, it's in the second little section there. It's 7160.
Oh, okay, dispatch revenue. Okay, that's where it is, right there. Okay, thank you very much.
That fee will go up next spring. Goes up every year.
Okay, good, thank you very much.
You ever?
Escalated the causes to go up?
It's based upon the Boston CPI.
Thank you.
Anybody over here with a question?
Just under state sources, and this is just from my own. Meals and rooms tax distribution from the state, $722,000 was the actual in 2014. It looks like it's projected out at $660,000. Do you have the figure on what Hampton sent to the state?
Something more than $7.2 million.
$7.2 million, and our share back was $722,000.
About 10%.
10%.
Yeah, and that depends upon how the legislature votes that distribution and how the state sets it. So we don't control any of that.
Right, I understand that. I just wanted to.
We got about 10% back. That figure's going to get refined. Up until this year, the state refused to provide figures to anyone. There was a state study committee now authorized by the legislature and the governor working on this problem, and they finally had to release by town. If you had 10 or more businesses located in the town, they had to give a list to the committee, so. And the list was not totally refined, but we know it's in excess of $7.2 million for Hampton.
Yep.
We're the third or fourth largest in the state.
Yeah, I saw that in the paper, and I think I even heard in your report as well.
Yeah.
67, and I figured about 10%. Basically, we're probably spending over $1 million a year with extra police and ambulances and DPW work, Fred.
We're spending a lot more than we're collecting.
Yeah, yeah, we're maybe half, maybe more, I don't know. As I recalled, we were like a million, million and a quarter, million and three, and we're getting about, when I was there, looking at the ambulance services, the extra police and the fire support, DPW and so on, so we're. Would you estimate that, Fred? Would you think we're getting about a third of what we need, or a half of what we need, or?
Well, I think we ought to get it all.
But we coop everything, you know.
I'm an equal opportunity. I take this whole 7.2 million and apply it to the tax.
No, but I mean, of what we're spending, you know, we.
Of what we're spending, we're probably collecting less than half.
Yeah. Well,
and
you know,
I'm probably being generous.
I was up in Stowe, Vermont this past summer, and I looked at, we went out to dinner, my wife and I and a couple of my grandkids. And guess what was on the bill was not only a state tax, but there was a town tax.
Yeah. We're the only state in New England that does not have a town tax.
Portsmouth pursued that.
And they did. We have to. Yeah. The legislature refuses to introduce it.
Okay.
I believe it.
Forget there's no free petition in New Hampshire.
It used to be under the umbrella known as the New Hampshire Advantage, right?
There's an advantage to something, but it's only to New Hampshire.
Which is what makes New Hampshire unique. That was the whole point.
Somewhat, yeah.
Do all the towns get the same percentage that they contribute back?
Their distribution is based upon permanent population of the town. So if you have 10,000 people in your town and no business establishments, you're going to get the same as a place that has 10,000 people with 150 business establishments. It doesn't make any difference what you contribute. It's set up on a formula because the legislature is controlled by the small cities and towns in New Hampshire. And they get, I know, I was a selectman in one of those towns of 400 people, and they get a huge chunk of money with nothing in the town. They're not willing to vote to give that up. So that's part of the problem. The commission's trying to solve that by trying to find a mechanism that will, in fact, take a portion of the state's money away and give that to the towns on a pro ratio basis.
Does the same problem exist with the rooms tax?
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Well, that's meals and rooms. That's the same.
Highway block rent is apportioned by the number of miles of town road you have versus the amount of gasoline tax. And I always went up this year simply because if you see the highway block grant, it's gone up some.
Yeah.
It's almost $300,000
right,
now.
$268,270.
When the gas tax extension passed, there was a provision in there that the cities and towns were to share a portion of that increase, about 50% of it. When it came due, the state said, well, we've changed our mind. We're keeping it all. It was such a hurrah about that they actually had to go back on their and give their word, keep it. So we did receive some extra money and will in the next few years as well.
Okay.
The parking lot revenues are doing fantastic.
Yes.
We might want to consider.
And that wasn't the best summer either.
No, but it's going up every year. She's doing a bang up job, the whole group there.
The concerts can help.
Yeah.
I mean, we may want to grab some land down there if it ever becomes available, Fred. And
we got a lot.
Yeah, the casino.
I know the Village District did. Well, we're proactive on that issue.
And we might, because, you know, that seems to be where the money is, right?
Yeah, but are you willing to appropriate the money to do it?
It's
$1 million for a lot, so based upon what the precinct bought this year, that's a lot of money for parking lot.
I guess what Jerry's saying is the more usable land owned by the government, the better the people are.
Okay.
That reminds me of something else the government says.
Exactly.
And a policy.
Yeah, on that note, let's go on to debt service if everybody
can I just ask one quick question? It has always bothered me, but we don't lease any parking spaces during the winter?
Yes, we do.
Yeah, we do, sure.
Not very many, but we do. It's on that same page with the parking lot revenue.
Yeah, $300.
Yep.
Yeah.
Is this because we don't plow anything?
Nobody there.
Nobody is interested.
Okay, I'm just asking. I mean, it's because I know
we
haven't plowed them.
In the wintertime that we do in the summer.
We don't turn anyone away. How's that for an answer? We have
one person in town.
We have one person in town who wants his car inside his front door. Yeah. All right.
We do plow all the parking lots now, with the exception of Church Street. And when we do have a snow emergency, we allow people to park in there for free until 7 o'clock in the morning. Get them off the street.
Right. Okay, thanks.
Christy?
Yes.
Ooh, we'll move on to debt service. Thank you.
It's down.
Good.
Perfect.
after we did the bond refinancing last year, we lost two more.
What page is that on?
It's on page 55.
55.
Principal payments are down 8.9. Let's see. Principal payments are down 8.75%, and interest is down 9.54%. So there's nothing new on there compared to the 2015 budget, and there's two that are no longer on there because they were part of the bond refinancing that we did in July of 14. Two of them still had payments in 15, so they were on your 15 schedule, but they are no longer. One was a herd farm, and one was part of the beach infrastructure from 2004 and 5.
Correct.
And was the recycling equipment on this one? We have one more year,
yes.
26
yep.
is on there. Yep.
1.292
million.
It's on there. It's yep. down about in the middle almost.
Oh, I see.
Number 1, 2, 3, 7. Number 7 on the list.
Hello. From the wastewater treatment.
Okay.
It runs out next year.
Yes, it has an expiration there in 2016.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
I am delighted to see the debt service down so much lower. It's great. You mentioned the herd farm finally got off the books.
Yeah.
Herd farm was one of those big purchases by the Conservation Commission, right? Bonded. How much was that? Do you remember? Like 1.2 million or something like that?
It says 2 million on there.
2 million. Oh, that one purchase alone, $2 million.
Yeah. Amazing. That's 2 million.
Amazing size, isn't it? Yeah.
The reason why I remember that, there was $1 million.
It was
not appropriately.
It was. Well, it absolutely was. But it related to the Conservation Commission activities, which is a topic of earlier concern. But I'm delighted to see that's gone. And hopefully, you know, we won't be seeing another herd trembling upon our tax rates in the future.
Buffalo or cows.
Whatever type. But I'm curious whether part of the reason this debt service is down is because perhaps some of the debt had been renegotiated.
It's in the very last thing. It says non-SRF bonds that were refinanced in 2014. I think there was
right.
five total
right.
that were combined into the one.
Now,
I don't want
anyone to think I'm grilling you, but I have been curious for some time on this question. I know, Fred, you can answer it. When we pass a bond, it says go out and get a $10 million bond for 10 years, we'll say. But it never says, and it can be renegotiated. So where do we get the authority to renegotiate it? Even though I love to renegotiate because they always save us money.
In statute.
It is in the statute.
It's
okay.
The finance statute.
So once the bond passes, it can be renegotiated. The moment the warrant article passes, it can be, the terms can be renegotiated?
Actually, no.
Okay.
What you're looking at in a renegotiation is you're going to be a number of years out. You have a small amount left in a number of bonds. For instance, all your bonds that are left for the sewer plant, the SRF funds, they can't be renegotiated. You're stuck with those for 20 years, whether you want them or not. They can't be changed.
But that's because it's in the terms of the bond, all right?
No, because it's a state bond.
I see. Okay.
And all the right. state just doesn't like to go through that process.
Okay.
All the other bonds, when they get an advanced age, the holders of the bond sometime will consent to have them renegotiated so they can get paid early.
Right.
That's the basis upon which you can do this.
But the curiosity of my question is the voters are part of that transaction in creating the bond.
The voters created it.
It strikes
and they
me
gave,
they would be part of the transaction in.
No, they gave the authority to the selectmen once it was and the treasurer once it was transacted to monitor those bonds and do what's necessary to take care of the
is
bonds.
Is that wording in the bond warrant article or is it somewhere else in statute?
It's in the statutes.
Okay, so I can find it in my nightly enjoyment of reading the state statutes, right?
Don't do it if you don't have to.
Oh, I can't help myself, Fred. Thank
this,
you.
This comes up every year.
I've never asked
what
that question.
What is TAN? That last step, 10,000?
Participation notes.
Okay, and yeah, what is that?
The selectmen have authority under statute, voted by town meeting. It's a non-rescinded article. They have the authority to go out and borrow funds in anticipation of the payment of property taxes and other taxes, so they can meet the obligations of the town to pay bills.
Okay, so it's a placeholder, basically, it's...
We haven't used it the last couple of years, but in the past, we have had to use it on several occasions.
When I arrived here, we were, this was a huge sum of money, this, we were talking hundreds of thousands of dollars a year in interest costs.
That was 2007.
Because our undesignated fund balance got down low, it was like...
No, the undesignated fund balance doesn't exist at that time.
Well, it's probably true.
It didn't at that time.
That's the point, I mean, you know...
So if the treasurer needs to go out and borrow to cover bills, we're waiting for the tax bills to go out, then that's where that money comes from.
But I think the point is, the larger the so-called surplus is, undesignated fund balance, the larger that is, the less likelihood there'll be a requirement for a tax anticipation notice.
Not necessarily.
No, I said less likely, I didn't say not likely.
Not, it could be less likely, but, you know, the history of this is an interesting history, because up until 2007, the town spent...
Yeah, I know, yeah.
All of the surplus every year. The problem was, and I proposed an ordinance to the selectmen, which they adopted, to regulate the surplus. The problem was, I think in the first year I was here, they had $747,000 worth of surplus, according to the auditors. $20 million worth of appropriations, and they had spent all but $747,000 of it, but they hadn't collected $3.2 million in taxes.
Yes.
So it's a funny money figure. Mm-hmm. So right now, the ordinance or requirements of the selectmen require us to hold at least in surplus the amount of unpaid taxes.
Good point, because I know the definition changes in the course of the years, and I should have said the actual real money in the surplus.
Oh, the real money, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And everything beyond that is real money, but you need to understand that the town and the school are on different payment schedules.
Right.
So we collect the school's money through the following June and December.
Right, and you have a similar problem with the village districts, whose generosity the village district has extended to delay that payment.
Well, actually, we pay them a one lump sum right after the tax rate is set.
I thought it was twice a year, Steve.
Unless you've changed the agreement.
No. Why don't we hold this out for when we do...
Well, the written agreement that was last made available to the public...
The agreement's subject to change. And when I first got here, it was one lump sum.
We're not going to talk about the village district in this meeting the same way.
When you got here, there wasn't a
written
agreement.
We're not going to talk about warrant articles. Thank you, Kim. Thank you, Fred.
I have a question.
You have one class question?
Yeah, why... You know, if I look at principal and look at interest, principal were 76% spent and interest were 70% spent. Right now, between the two accounts, we have a huge variance of $837,347. Now, is that going to be a real positive variance that we have at the end of the year?
No.
It won't be any variance at the end
so
of
that,
the
year.
Usually, we should be almost right on those accounts. We get those bills come in...
So this is a non-linear spend
rate. A lot of them are due, some are due in April, some in July, and then a whole bunch in December.
Okay. So this line item will be spent.
Yep.
Yes.
I would think so. I mean, you should be able to, you know...
Because we have the schedule. So the only thing that changes maybe a little will be the interest, but it should be fair, they should come in at budget.
Right, okay, so it comes in, would you say, three times a year, four times a year, the payments?
I mean, it might be a little off because...
I would think we'd be paying every month.
No.
Pay your mortgage rate every month, you know?
No.
But these are bonds.
Bonds.
There's only one that we pay on a monthly basis, and I will not swear to it while I'm sitting here, but I'm pretty sure it's the recycling.
Yeah,
the one that Eileen had mentioned earlier. I'm pretty sure that's the one that we pay monthly, but we only pay one bond payment on a monthly basis.
And the recycling's a note, it's not...
Yeah, it's a note with profit.
But you're confident that these budgeted line items for interest as well as principal will be pretty close to being on target?
I was going to add that we took two on this year, so it'll depend on when the budget was made. We did not have the repayment schedules, the official repayment schedules. It was the Church Street pump station, and one of the wastewater ones came on this year for the first time through the SRF. So those
renewal
ones,
of plant.
So maybe a little off, but they came in very close. I do remember when we actually got the loan agreements, it was close.
So we're not going to have this big positive variance that
we
I see.
We will not
right
have
here
a big positive variance there. Sorry.
Wish we could.
I had some thoughts about it if
I'm
we did.
I'm sure you did. That's what I'm saying. I'm sorry.
No free cocoa at the meetings.
Christie, Fred, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I have a question.
You had a question?
Yeah, I've been having my hand up here for a couple of days.
Anybody else have a question? Because at some point we need to.
Do you have the undesignated fund balance with you tonight?
I do not have the undesignated.
We try not to carry it around. It's very cumbersome.
Can we get that? Because that was a question we requested.
I believe I requested it. She gave it to me last week. It's about 4.7 million.
I didn't get the answer back myself, but I'm the one who originated the question.
Oh, then I apologize.
I was going to say, I brought something into Eileen last week when she asked. I think you asked on Thursday.
I met it.
Is that 4.7 with or without uncollected taxes?
Well, no. It's simple. Madam Chair, you got an email from Christie. Could you email the entire budget committee?
I'll send it to you.
The entire budget committee, please.
Does that 4.7 include outstanding taxes that are due?
Does it include outstanding taxes?
Yeah, the people haven't paid their taxes.
The number that you were referring to, that the.
Because in the audit of 13, for example, two point something was the undesignated fund balance. It was 4.8 with the outstanding taxes that were due to the town.
When we talk about outstanding taxes, we're talking about the taxes that are leaned.
Yeah.
Taxes are not outstanding until they're lien, which is up to 18 months after the first issuance of the bill.
Well, I believe you meant to say unpaid taxes.
Unpaid taxes.
Right, they're unpaid.
Yeah. Okay.
So when are we going to get the audit for 14 going along that?
In the next week or so.
Because I was looking at 13, and it was 2 point something for the undesignated fund balance, and there was, but the total, including the outstanding taxes, was 4.8. So I was trying to bring that along to cover this year's and, you know, for 14's audit, because we haven't got it yet. And it looks like to me we might, if we spend $1 million last year, we spend $500,000 this year, we're getting close to the end of the real money. Based on an assumption there, because I haven't seen 14's audit yet.
That's an assumption, but our understanding from the auditors was that the on reserve fund balance prior to the setting of the tax rate was $5 million.
Okay. And the audits can be done next week, you think?
Within the next week or so.
Good show. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Yeah, I need clarity on that, if you don't mind. Fred, the tax bills we just got, were they the result of a $500,000 withdrawal from the?
Yes.
Okay, so that figure of 4.7 that I just heard is net of that $500K that we.
The estimate that was given to us by the auditors, hadn't finished the audit at the time they did it, was approximately $5 million in the surplus account. And we took $500,000 out, okay? Now, it could be 5.2 or 5.1, you know, but.
So the four and a half sits, let's say
four and a half million.
Yeah, and that sits. As an isolated amount right now, but if some of these warrant articles go through, you're drawing from that'll come down.
Yes, and we'll be putting more money in at the end of the year.
From here, you're spending pretty well close to your line right now. So
well, we're looking. There'll be money put in at the end of the year.
Yeah,
we're not sure how much
you've got about 4.5 before any warrant articles get passed.
It could be we're going to put as much or more in than we're going to take out. It's just hard to say right now until we get to the end of December.
Yeah, well, that's why I was hoping the positive variance that I see in the debt.
I mean, we've got, what was it, $200,000 projected over in revenues?
$100,000 maybe.
Okay, that overage in revenue is going to go into surplus.
Oh, Fred, this is a positive that we threw out last year. We know we have things going on the Warren articles as things that some of the departments need. And if, as you say, we're going to have possibly even more money. Last year we said if there was leftover money when you got to the end of the year that you could eliminate some of the Warren articles.
Yeah.
We obviously are going to look at that because the selectmen said last year we would continue to look at that. I'm asking the department heads to give me a listing of priorities as of Tuesday. This coming Tuesday we'll be talking about it. If the board approves, some of those warrant articles may disappear.
That's exactly where I was coming from.
Sometimes we, usually we're saying don't spend money, but in last year's case, and again in this year's case.
But I mean, I know the fire department has got some real critical ones.
Yeah.
you know, like clothing and
all that. Last year they did as well, and we took some of those away.
And the police has some real critical ones.
Right.
And if we could use some of that excess right here.
And that would be up to management.
We could cut out some of these more
excesses and where to apply.
We know what we're doing at the end of the year. We'll make some recommendations to the board, and the board will consider those and make a decision of which they want to do.
Right, and then we'll get our chance to weigh in at that time, but let's not be premature.
No, but I mean, okay. We're just discussing.
All right. I think we've killed this.
It's a dead beast.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a good day tomorrow.
Thank you, Christy.
Thank you.
Good night, Fred.
Before everybody skedaddles, we've been asking for a date for DPW for the subcommittee.
Yeah.
And we have two, either this Saturday or December, is it 5th? Is that the date of the parade? December 3rd or December 5th?
The 5th.
The 5th. So
you can't make that.
You can't make that one. So are you available this Saturday?
Well, it's pretty short notice,
I know.
Well, it's not Saturday.
I guess
if that's the only choice, I guess that's what's going to have to work.
Okay. So
morning. How about the morning?
Yeah, or 9 o'clock.
An afternoon commitment. Mm-hmm. Morning, I can get there at 9 o'clock, Mike.
Yeah, pick a time.
All right, I'll let Chris know.
Yeah.
That Saturday morning is okay with you guys?
Yeah, we'll be there at 9.
And 9 o'clock, if it's any different, I'll call you and tell you.
Well, Madam Chair.
We got it. He came back to me, but he went through the Board of Selectmen, and I didn't pick it up on Monday night's meeting.
He has it May.
So, whatever. Do I have a motion to
adjourn? No, wait a minute.
I'll second the motion.
Oh, come on, Jerry. I know you like it here.
We don't need mosquito control in here next week either.
Oh,
good point.
Cancel. Come on, you know, I mean, that's the end at Kaiser. She's going to come in 100,000, 103, or whatever it is. She spends it exactly. She's got the supplier all filled. We're happy the mosquitoes are
Does
dead.
Anybody have any questions
Jerry.
For mosquitoes?
Okay, we're good.
Yeah.
We'll let her know that she doesn't need to come in
okay,
next
thank
week.
Thank you, Jerry.
All right.
My motion for adjournment is on the table.
Seconded by Stephen.
One question. You've got a bunch of minutes here.
It's not on the agenda.
We only just got the minutes.
You only just got them. We'll go over them in the next meeting.
That'll be a whole meeting.
All those in favor of adjourning?
Yes. Unanimous. Wow.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Marlene.
All right.